Hey everybody, Kanad from ReadMe here. Today we're going to go over how to set up a personalized docs webhook. So for this demo, we're going to be using the Node and NPM versions I have here. As of this recording, anything above Node 14 should work just fine. But if you have any questions at all, don't be afraid to, contact our support team. So before we get into it, let's talk about what personalized docs are. Personalized docs are essentially a way for you to inject custom user data into your docs. So for example, I have here the README API reference. As you can see, I'm logged in as Albert Gupta, and you can see that my API keys are pre-filled in the reference section, and I can select them from a little drop-down list here. You can also surface this kind of information in your docs too. So you can see I'm logged into this demo project we're going to be working on today, and you can see that, hey, Albert Gupta, my email address is this, and your username is this. And if we look at the actual editor, you can see here that we have these variable placeholders. There's a lot of creative ways to use personalized docs. So you can see here that we have this user variable. And because we have no data being populated for it, it just defaults to this uppercase user. We have this name and this email variable that's being populated. And any user that has an account with README will automatically have these populated, but a lot of your users might not have an account with us, and there is a lot of other possibilities for data that you can populate here, such as, usernames, API keys, server variables, what have you. So we have this user, so why don't we give it a better default? So let's go into the section of the dashboard where you can set up personalized docs. So here it is. So this loom stuff is in the way. So configuration and then personalized docs is how you get to this. And so let's add a variable default. So we're trying to add a variable default for the user variable, and let's just call it your username here. That's just gonna be the default placeholder. So any logged out user or any user that is missing this user attribute in the user data payload will show this. So if we refresh this, you see that this variable default was populated accordingly. So if we actually wanted to inject some custom user data for this, this will require the personalized docs webhook. And it's a webhook that you set up in your application that has access to your secure user data. So anytime that a new user logs into README, we will send a post request to your webhook, which will in turn have to respond with user data, which we will then surface in your docs. So let's go through these setup steps here. So the first step is to install ngrok, which I believe I have installed already, yes. And we're gonna have to copy this code sample. So I'll be doing this with Node.js today. So we're gonna copy this code sample into this repository that I have. I have this open API file in here, that's all I have. We'll go over how we're gonna be using this later. So the first step is to copy that code sample into your code base. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna save this. I'm just gonna call this index.js, let's say. And so you can see here that this is a Node.js server and it has some NPM dependencies here. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna create a new package.json file. So you can run npm init y, it creates a little default template here that I'm gonna use. And so I'm going to install the dependencies for Express and README.io, because those are the ones listed at the top here. All right. So let's just go down the line understanding what's going on here. So we have this secret that is attached to your README project. Every request that comes from README will have this unique signature that we're going to have to verify. And so this README.io package that we've built, it's available in a bunch of different programming languages, will verify the signature on that request. That is to ensure that the requests are in fact coming from README itself. The next step, once the signature is validated, is to grab the user information from the database, whatever database or data store that you may have, and then send that in this payload back to README. So the first step is to start the server. So we will just do node index.js here. We can see that this example app is listening at port 8000. I'm assuming there's no standard entry point, so this is not going to work. but that's okay. So what we're gonna do is set up the ngrok tunnel for it. So as we can see in the setup instructions, we have this command here that we're gonna run. And this is going to create a unique URL for anybody in the world to access the web server running on your laptop. So it's great for debugging tools like this. Shout out to ngrok. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna copy this into here. So the next step here, they want us to paste our test data into here. So let's paste this URL into here and see what happens. So if we paste this in, and then let's try my email address here, and we click try it. Endpoint not found. Did you forget the path in your server URL? Ah, yes. So this is being posted to this path within my server. So I'm gonna tack on this slash webhook. And let's try that and see what happens. No data received. Yeah, so it looks like we haven't actually sent any data. And the one thing we did want to fill in was this username. Let's tack on user test user and see what happens here. So let's try this again. Interesting. Oh, do you know what I need to do? I need to restart my server. Do that. And then if I go back to this page, boom, test user. And we're getting back the correct data. Okay, awesome. So let's go to this next step here. And so what they want you to do is put in the link to your actual production server and not just the ngrok URL. Because this is just a demo, we're gonna pretend that our ngrok little server on my laptop is our production system. So bear with me for that part of this. So let's, you know, try this again. We're gonna do knod plus Albert. And vimi.io. We're gonna try it one more time. It's working. Awesome. So we're gonna click save. Amazing. We've set it up. Alright, so let's click close here. If I log into the docs again, you can see here that the username is test user. Amazing. So obviously this is cool, but let's zhuzh this up a little bit and actually make this some custom user data as opposed to just another like placeholder here. So let's make some changes to our web server code. So because I am just testing this with my email address, I'm gonna do some weird function to mimic an actual database query to figure out what the username field might be. So we have the email address in this rec.body. So what we could do here is get the email address by creating a variable like so. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna create a new variable called user. And we're just gonna say that that's gonna be the email address. And we're gonna, so like, you know, my email address looks something like this, right? Where it's gonna be knod plus Albert at readme.io. So let's swap out everything. So it'll turn it into Albert. So what we're gonna do here is we're gonna replace knod plus with just an empty string. And we're also gonna replace at readme.io with an empty string. All right, and so we save that. And how about instead of this test user here, we're gonna return this guy. So let's save that. We're gonna restart our server this time. All right, and so if I log out and log back into the docs, you can see here the username is Albert. So that's awesome. So the thing is, I'm an administrator. I already have an account on README, right? I have this Albert Gupta situation. What does this look like for a user that is not on README? So let's log into this incognito here. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna call our username test in this case, knod test at readme.io. We're gonna send ourselves a login link. All right, so the login link is here. I'm gonna copy that. Awesome, and you can see here that the username is test. And because I don't have an account with README, we just fall back to using the email address as the name. But let's, you know, hypothetically, if we wanted to also have the user be that user variable, we can populate it like this. Or we could do something kind of fancy and, you know, we could do something like a first name and last name type situation. So let's see how that goes. We're gonna log out here. I'm gonna log back in. This time we'll do Kanad at hello at readme.io. All right, so you can see this one just came in. Boom. You can see that my name here is Hello Gupta. So that's an example of how to populate some basic user data into readme. Up next, let's try syncing an OpenAPI file and see how API keys can be surfaced. So first up, you're going to want to have an OpenAPI file that has some authentication or security scheme set up. So I have like a basic example here, literally a basic example using basic authentication. So what we're going to do is we're going to use the RDME CLI to sync this to our project. So I am logged in to this project already. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just type in RDME OpenAPI. We'll use an existing version. Awesome. So I can check out this link in the dashboard and it'll take me to my API docs, which you can see are created here. So let's just make sure the reference section is enabled. And if I log in here, you can see that the user is automatically populated into here. And you're probably asking yourself how. So we have some docs on how to construct that user data object. And essentially what we did was we used a special keyword here called user. And this pre-fills the basic auth username in the authentication section of the API reference. So you can see here that Albert was able to log in successfully. And so if I refresh the page, will this show up for hello accordingly? Yes, it will. So you can do a bunch of crazy things here. This works with API keys, this works with bearer tokens, regardless of how you're sending the API key. So you can pre-populate a list of keys as such. So let's try sending an array of API tokens. So if we look at the user data options here, one user with multiple keys. So what we'll do here is let's try doing something like this. So instead of just a single user like this, we're gonna have a list of keys. We're gonna label this my first project, my second project. All right, and instead of the user being Mark and Mark 2, let's take that user variable we have up above and we're just gonna do something like this. But instead of user Gupta, we're gonna call this user one. We're gonna call this user two. Awesome. All right. So if we go back, we're gonna have to restart our server again. So if I log out, and I can log back in as such. Let's see, will those populate correctly? Boom. All right. Amazing. So as you can see here, we have like a list of API keys that a user can set up. This is a great way, you know, when somebody has a bunch of different API tokens in the mix, this is a great way to have their API keys ready for them to be able to make requests right away. That's been it for this demo. If you have any questions, please check out our docs, contact us at support@readme.io. If you have any questions, take care, y'all. Bye.